Good afternoon to all of you. Welcome to the webinar today, Cornerstone of Scientific Publication 2. The webinar is organized by Innovative Education and Scientific Research Foundation in collaboration with Innovative Publication. Today, the topic covers in the Cornerstone of Scientific Publication is how to write a specific paper and type of manuscript. Please check your audio and video setting before we start. If you are having any difficulties regarding the audio and video in this webinar, then please let us know through the comment box. We will try to help it out. Today's webinar comprises four sessions: introduction, presentation by speakers, question answer session, and thanks vote. If you have any question, ask them in question box at the bottom of your screen. We will try to answer as many as unique question as we can. If somehow we could not answer your question due to time constraint, then you can email us your queries at editor.isrf@gmail.com or editorialoffice@ipinnovative.com. Thank you for your cooperation. So we'll start with the introduction session. So I will introduce first Dr. Dinesh Kansal, who is the key speaker of today's webinar. Dr. Dinesh Kansal is MBBS, MD in Pharmacology, HOD in Pharmacy Department, Dr. RPG, MC, Kangra, Himachal Pradesh. Pharmacology Department, HOD in the Pharmacology Department, Dr. RPGM, Kangra, Himachal Pradesh. He is the Editor-in-Chief in Indian Journal of Pharmacy and Pharmacology. Had write more than 40 publications in national and international journal and enlisted on the ResearchGate and Google Scholar with all details. On the reviewer board of textbook of numerous them, then chairman IEC Pandit JLNG MC Chamba. He has guided 21 pharmacology students pursuing two multi-center project approved by ICMR or Delhi in a collaboration of PGMIR Chandigarh. Our another key speaker is Dr. Hema Bendu. She is MSc PhD Microbiology and serving as an associate professor microbiology at Malla Reddy Institute of Medical Sciences, Hyderabad. Dr. Hema Bendu is associate professor in microbiology at the Institute of Medical Science, Hyderabad. She has completed her PhD from Savita University and her PG from Institute of Basic Medical Sciences under the leadership of eminent researcher Dr. S.P. Tiarunkari. Her interest is in research lead to work on antimicrobial effect of nanoparticles. She had published over 25 papers in both international and national journals. She is the research director of the student wing in Malla Reddy Institute of Medical Science. She has guided many MBBS students, PGs, and PhD scholars in the research world. She is a member of scientific committee and the medical education unit of her college. Welcome, Dr. Kansal. Welcome, Dr. Hema Bendu.
Thank you.
Now I would like to introduce it in a short Innovative Education and Scientific Research Foundation. Innovative Education and Scientific Research Foundation is a non-profit organization and working with a goal to help researcher fraternity to disseminate their research globally by publishing in a peer review journals, by presenting in conference, research talks, seminar, webinar, etc. The main vision is to promote scientific research globally and provide a platform to the community that tends to improve the visibility of work internationally. IESRF is an association of more than 3,000 members. For more information in detail, please go through our website www.iesrf.org and become a member for getting exclusive benefits. Now, IP Innovative Publication Private Limited is a publisher in medical and allied sciences. Innovative publishes high quality peer review open access article in all specialties. Here are some reasons to publish with the experience with us and experience our exceptional services. To know more, please visit www.ipinnovative.com and submit your manuscript at www.innovpub.org. Thank you. After this event is completed, please share your feedback to serve you better on www.iesrf.org/feedback. This is automatically appeared in your computer after the completion of this event. And download your e-certificate after the completion of webinar from the same website. Thank you. Now I would like to request Dr. Kansal to share his presentation.
Hello, good evening everybody. I will be talking about the how to write a scientific paper. I have been introduced by Mrs. Nikita Pandit. I am head of the department in pharmacology in Dr. RPGMC, Kangra. So it is a general guide to how to write a scientific paper. Am I audible to everybody? So the significant portions of this presentation are adopted from the Innovative Education and Scientific Research Foundation presentation of 2020. Additional material is adopted from Cornerstone of Scientific Publication 2 workshop material, and I will be covering how to write a scientific paper. Task of writing a research paper can be very daunting, very difficult, and even with the groundbreaking research, unless the paper is correctly written, at best the publication will be delayed, that you all have experienced, and at the worst it can never be published. And my presentation will provide an overview of how to write a well-structured research paper for publication. The priorities of the author are, it is the quality should be there and the speed of publication should be fast, and the referring speed should be fast, referring standards should be very good, and reputation of the journal is also very important for the author. Then the editors of the author, editorial board of the publisher, then physical quality of the journal and the publication services are also concerned. In the author behavior, the author wants to publish more, and the publication should be peer reviewed, and other functions of the journal are very important, and it should be widely disseminated. For the reader, important is that the system should be integrated. Browsing is also crucial, and quality information is important, and he wants to read less. So for the reader, the article should be of very good quality, access should be easily available, delivery should be rapid, and the publication should be in the convenient format, and there should be linking of the information. and cost should be very low or it should be freely available. And the information should be up to date. Latest information should be there. So the authors are usually journal focused. They are looking for a good journal. And readers are article focused, means what is available in the journal, that is their important content of the articles. And so author wants to publish more and readers want to read less. And then there are various main key elements of publishing. Like first are the ethical issues. I will be dealing with them one by one. Then the style and language is also important. Then structure of the paper. Then components of the paper. Then the submission of the articles and the selection of the journals. Then process at the point of the publisher and review by the peers. So first the ethical issues. So in the ethics, one should disclose whether is if there is any conflict of interest. Then the if there is any funding resources, that should be acknowledged. Then image manipulation guidelines should be there. And online submission should be available. And for the health sciences articles, the clinical trial should be registered in the central registry with the CTRI in India. And from the institutional review board should have approved your work. Then the style and language. So every journal gives the guide to the author in which style he should submit it. And some authors write their paper with a specific journal in mind, and others write the paper and then adapt it to fit the style of a journal which they subsequently choose. Main objective is to report your findings and conclusions clearly and concisely as far as possible. And for example, in India, main language is the English. And if English is not your first language, then you should find a native English speaker, if it is possible, to review the content and language of the paper before submitting it. And if English is not your primary language, then you should find a colleague or editor to review the content and the language of the paper. The commonly cited types of references are shown here. For other types of references, such as electronic media, like newspaper items, so you should refer to the ICM JEE guidelines. So they provide the, there you can know how to submit. These are the links for contacting the ICM JEE and the National Library of Medicine. So scientific writing follows a very rigid structure. The format has been developed over hundreds of years, so you cannot deviate from them. Consequently, a paper can be read at several levels. For example, some people just will refer to the title only. Others will read the title and the abstract. And very few will read the paper for a deeper understanding. So these are the various components of a paper. First is the title. Title clearly describes the contents. So the message is conveyed by the from the title only, but what is present in this paper. then the names of the authors. So this is the recognition for the writers of the paper. Then the abstract. So in short form, the what was done is described in the abstract. Then in some journals, keywords are there. So for keywords are required for identification of the that article from the like search engines like PubMed. Then the introduction. Introduction explains the problem. What was the research question? So that should be there in the introduction. Then in the methods, you explain the how the data was collected. Then in the results, you should describe what was discovered. In the discussion, we discuss the what are the implications of the these findings. In the acknowledgments, we acknowledge who else helped in the research. And in the references, the previously published work that is recognized and we cover it in the references. And in some journals, appendices are also required. So they provide the supplemental data for the expert reader. So I will deal with one by one. First, the authors listing. In the authors, you should include only those who have made an intellectual contribution to the research. Not everybody is to be included. Or those who will publicly defend the data and conclusions and who have approved the final version. So they should be able to defend. Order of the names of authors can vary from discipline to discipline. In some fields, the corresponding author's name appears first. Title describes the paper's content clearly and precisely, and the keywords should be included in the title. And title is the advertisement of the article. And in the title, abbreviation should not be used, and it should be in a simple language. The language should not be complicated. It should be easy to understand. Because search engines and indexing databases depend on the accuracy of the title, since they use the keywords to identify relevant articles. For example, a person is searching for that, he will put some keywords. So if the keywords are there in the title, then that your publication will be visible to the searcher. The abstract should be written usually in about 150 words. It is a summary of the work. And in this, we will include the what is the problem, that is, what is the research question, what is the methodology, then what are the results, and the conclusion. So that is called a structured abstract. On the first, you will write down the in the introduction the what you are looking for, what is your research question, then the method that is used, then the results, what you found, and the conclusion. So four topics are there. So from the reading the abstract, the reader can decide whether he should read that article or not. Means he should not, he may not go into the all of the article, but from just looking at the abstract, he can decide whether this is useful, this paper is useful for him or not. Together, the title and the abstract should stand on their own. That is, they should, the maximum information should be available in the title and the abstract. So many authors, what they do is, they first write down the article and then they write the abstract. So the important things can be included in the abstract. So The abstract should reflect the contents of the paper. In the introduction, you should state what is the problem being investigated, that is, what is the research question. Then, secondly, background that explain the problem, that is, whatever literature you have searched, review in the review of literature, that is to be included. And then the thirdly is the reasons for conducting the research. Means in the literature you will see what has been already, what is available in the literature, and then what you will be looking for. So you should summarize relevant research to provide the context. State how your work differs from the published work. So means it should be different from the already published work. Identify the questions you are answering. What has not been found out so far, that should be identified. Explain what are the other findings, if any, you are challenging or extending. So means this much is available in the literature so far, and we will be looking for this new thing. That is the research question. Briefly describe, in this you will briefly describe the experiment, that is the materials and methods what will be done, then the hypothesis, research question, general experimental design of the method. So that should be clearly stated. In the methods, you will provide the reader enough details so they can understand and replicate your research. So method should be very clearly stated. So there should not be any difficulty in understanding the methodology. Explain how you studied the problem, identify the procedures you followed, and order these chronologically where possible. And if you are using a new method, it should be discussed in detail. Otherwise, if it is a previously well established method, then the name of the method is only sufficient. Then you will include the frequency of observations and what type of data were recorded. Be it precise in describing the measurements and include the if there is any error of measurement or if there is any limitation in the research design. In the results, you will objectively present your findings and explain what was found. You will show that your new results are contributing to the body of the scientific knowledge. Follow a logical sequence based on the tables and figures presenting the findings to answer the research question or the hypothesis. So they should be in a logical sequence, they should be explained. Figures should have a brief description, that is called legend. And the legend, these figures, they provide the reader sufficient information to know how the data was produced. Then the discussion. In the discussion or conclusion, you will describe what your results mean in context of what was already known about the subject. So here it will be means comparison, means what was already known, what the earlier authors have described for that particular subject, and then in comparison, what are our findings. Discussion indicates how the results relate to the expectations and to the literature previously cited. So were the results according to your expectations or research question that is to be given. Explain How the research has moved the body of scientific knowledge forward means what was known before your work and is what is the improvement for the people. Do not extend your conclusions beyond what is directly supported by your results. Avoid undue speculation. So whatever your results show, that should be discussed in the conclusion, not that what is not visible in the results, that should not be projected. Any speculation should be avoided. And then you can outline the next steps. What you can suggest is that it means these are the limitations of the study, and in future the work can be done on these aspects. Then the references. Whenever you draw upon previously published work, you must acknowledge the source. So the other work should be referenced, and in a scientific way, that we will come to that. Any information not from your experiment and not common knowledge should be recognized by a citation. Right? How references are presented varies considerably. So in the for a particular journal, whether the in which style they require the references, whether it is in the Harvard style or Vancouver style, that should be referred to, and the references should be given accordingly. Avoid references that are difficult to find. So they should be avoided. And you should avoid listing related references that were not important to the study. So unnecessarily, references should not be added. So these are the samples of formatted references for authors of the journal articles. The International Committee of Medical Journal Editors, ICMJE, offers guidance to the authors in its publication recommendation for the conduct, reporting, editing, and publication of scholarly work in medical journals, that is ICMJE recommendations, which was formerly the union uniform requirements for manuscripts. The recommended style for references is based on the National Information Standards Organization bibliographic references as adopted by the National Library of Medicine for its databases. So the various works are to be referenced in different ways. Like there is for the articles in journals, there is a different way of referencing. Then if you want to reference, give a reference of some book or other monographs, the method is different. For other published material, there's different guidelines. For unpublished material, different guidelines are there. And for the electronic material that you search from the web, the guidelines are separate. For example, this is a sample. For example, Agarwal A, Agarwal T, Sharma R, Jori N, Bhamra S, a study of KI67 expression in oral squamous cell carcinoma. Then the name of the journal, Indian Journal of Pathology Oncology, 2019 semicolon 6 within brackets 4 colon 579 to 585. So if there are up to 6 contributors, then all the 6 names should be there. But if it is more than 6, then the first 6 contributors should be followed by et al. There should not be any gaps between the year, volume, and the page. Like this here, 2019, semicolon 6 within brackets 4, and then colon 579 to 585. So there is no gap, right? So these are some other examples are also there for reference. So there are various types of manuscripts like original articles and case reports. The title of the article should be concise, and but it should be informative. And in the short title, there should not be more than 65 characters. The name by which each author contributor is known, that is, first the last name will be written, then the first name and initials of the middle name. And institutional affiliation should be shown. The affiliation should be given as numbers 1, 2 and 3, but not marked with the symbols. Then the name of the department and institution, name of the institution to which the work should be attributed. The name, address, phone numbers, facsimile or fax numbers, and email address of the contributor responsible for correspondence. It should be given the complete name, address, phone number, fax number, and email of the author for correspondence should be given. The total number of pages, total number of photographs, and the word counts should be given separately for the abstract and for the text. And this should not count the references and the abstract. If there is any source of support in the form of grants, equipment, or drugs, or all of these, that should be stated. And acknowledgement, if any, acknowledgement should be made if there is one or more statements should specify the contributions that need acknowledge, but do not justify the authorship, such as general support by the departmental chair, then acknowledgements of technical help and acknowledgements of financial and material support, which should specify the nature of the support. This should be included in the title page of the manuscript and not in the main article file. If the manuscript was presented as part of a meeting, the organization, place, and exact date on which it was read, and the registration number of the clinical trial and the registration number of the institutional ethics committee should also be there. So these we have covered. And after you submit your article, most journal editors will make an initial decision on a paper whether it is to be reviewed or it should be rejected. And most editors appoint 2 referees. And referring speed varies tremendously between the journals. Authors should receive a decision of accept, or it should be in the form of accept with the revision. Revision can be minor or major or reject. So 3 types of decisions come to the author. If a paper is rejected, most editors will write to you explaining the reason of the rejection. After rejection, authors have the option of submitting the paper to another journal. So, editor's suggestion should be addressed. So, what are the tips for publishing your article? That is, editors and reviewers are looking for original and innovative research that will add to the field of the study. So, for research-based papers, ensure that you have enough numbers to justify sound statistical conclusion. So that your sample size should be good. It should be calculated first and then. For a larger study, it may be better to produce one important search paper rather than a number of average incremental papers. This is the Committee on Publication Ethics. So they look after if there are any unethical work is going on, if there is any allegations of misconduct, and if there is any dispute on the authorship and contributorship, if there are any complaints and appeals, if there is any conflict of appeals, and if there is any problem with the data and reproducibility. Then there is International Committee of Medical Journal Editors. Then these are the publishing and editorial issues. That like there can means editor will ask for the corrections, retractions, republications, and version control. Then there can be, if there is any scientific misconduct, expression of concern and retraction, copyright issues, over if there is any overlapping of the publications, then correspondence, then fees. So then supplements, theme issues and special series, sponsorship or partnership, electronic publishing, advertising, journal and the media, clinical trials. This is the WAMME, World Association of Medical Editors. So if there is any conflict of interest in the peer-reviewed medical journals, study design and ethics, authorship, peer review, editorial decisions, in the originality, prior publication and media relations, plagiarism, advertising, responding to allegations of possible misconduct, relation of the journal to the sponsoring society, if it is applicable. Then there is Council of Scientific Science Editors. Then the editor's roles and responsibilities. There is editorial freedom, confidentiality, conflict of interest disclosure should be there, citation manipulation, editorial board participation, timelines of publication process, errata, if there are any errors, retractions and expressions of concern, addressing disputes, considering appeals, authorship for reconsideration of rejected manuscripts, addressing allegations or findings of misconduct, preprint servers, references, resources and case studies, then the appendix. Then there is NISO. Then the indexing of the medical journals are done in various ways like PubMed Central, Index Copernicus, DOAJ, Google Scholar, Scopus, Web of Science, Science Citation Index Expanded, ProQuest, Inari, IP Indexing, JGate, Shimago Journal Ranking. Thanks.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your valuable presentation. Now, I would like to request Dr. Hima Bindu to share her thoughts on that.
That was a real exhaustive presentation. And I hope everybody who has heard would know now how to write an original research article for publication, especially the newer researchers who are out there. So, thank you, sir. It was really, really good. Yes, ma'am.
Ma'am, can you please share your presentation? Yeah.
Yeah, is it visible? Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am, you are audible. Your screen is visible.
Okay. Good evening, everybody. At the outset, let me thank Innovative Publications for giving me this wonderful opportunity to talk on my favorite topic, research. Today, my topic for the day is types of manuscripts. I do hope that amongst this august audience, we have academicians as well as young researchers for whom this topic is going to be useful. We are all scientists and we are all into a lot of research in our respective fields. What is the most important thing for a scientist who has done immense amount of work to tell the world about his ideas and theories? And just like the news is spread to the people by means of newspapers and magazines, the scientific knowledge is dispersed in journals. When we talk about manuscripts to be published in these journals, we should know that there are many types of articles written in different formats. Today, I'll be trying to tell you about a few of them. Now, these are some of the types of manuscripts that are published by the journals. We will be dealing with a few of them. The most important one amongst them is the original research article. What is this? As I said earlier, we all want our hard work that we put in our research to be read and acknowledged. The original research article does just that. All the work that is written in the way that Dr. Kansal had mentioned elaborately in his presentation. This article contains the idea, whether it's a new idea or a theory or a data which is not done previously. It could be an experiment or a discovery or even a simulation. This is the best way to share a new finding or even a way to establish an older finding. Nowadays, we have so much work going on COVID that many such original articles are being published a lot. So what is the basic methodology that brings us to the publication level? Well, this is a slide that's something that all the researchers, whether they are juniors or seniors, know like the back of your hand. The research process consists of arriving at a research problem, doing an extensive review of literature to support your work, to formulate your hypothesis based on this review, formulate a research design. Based on this design, you will collect the required data, analyze it, and finally interpret it. Now, your work is ready for publication. The contents of the original research article has already been taken in detail. IMRDC is the mantra for original research article. What's that? Introduction, materials and methods, research, discussion, conclusion. Introduction would contain the hypothesis as well as the lacuna that was there in the other studies, which will lead to the need of your study and the aims and objectives. In this kind of paper, one must remember that it is their research work that is being published. So the materials and methods and the results are of utmost importance, because the data that you're going to be presenting is going to be included in an already present scientific data as an additional piece of information. Now, these are some of the studies that can be published as an original research article: clinical trials, comparative studies, blind double-blind studies, prospective and retrospective studies, cohort observational studies, basically any interventional studies. Each of them has a definite structure, and findings are performed and analyzed by the researcher or his team of researchers, and the probable implications are discussed in the paper. So all your results have to be positive in line with the previous similar studies? Not necessarily. If the research is genuinely done with all the proper correct methods and the results are opposite to what is available in the literature, even that is credible, worth mentioning in the original article. This is very much accepted and published by all the journals. So who writes this type of research article? The person or persons who are doing the research. Usually they are the experts in their field, or even a young researcher with an expert as a guide or a supervisor. This type of a publication is a source of knowledge to all of them who are there in the field with an interest in the subject. Since the language could be a little technical, the person who are reading it must be in a position to understand. What is it that the researcher must remember while writing his publication? The matter has to be crisp. The people reading are knowledgeable, looking for the latest information. So you can use a lot of technical words and data. This is the complete work that you have spent months or maybe years. So spend more time on the materials and methods and result with a proper backup in the discussion. Normally, you would not use more than 35 references, and the word limit is normally around 3,000 to 4,000 words. One of the most common original articles nowadays, especially, are the clinical trials. Especially in the case of COVID vaccine production, there are rigorous assessment of the vaccine production and its side effects. The tests are done in animals first, and then the reactions, effects, side effects are noted, and these are presented as an original article. The materials and methods are usually in very minute detail so that it can be duplicated in other studies. Since this study affects all of us in general, maybe because it's a new drug or maybe a new vaccine, the sample size normally is very large. And the persons who conduct these trials have to be very proficient in their work and have to have an extensive practical knowledge. Since these clinical trials involve live animals and humans, as Dr. Kansal has said, it also involves very high standards of ethics. This is an example of an original research article. You can see the headings are as per the IMRDC and the references. The references are around 30 to 35 as is shown in the figure. There will be a few figures and tables which will explain the work of the researcher in the original article. Review articles are another very important, very common type of paper. Usually there will be one or two review articles in every issue of the journal. So what is a review article? This is basically a comprehensive summary of the research that is done in a particular field. So it requires a vast and exhaustive search of the literature that is available on the topic. The information that we acquired may be scattered in all these sources. So all this data must be consolidated, systematically analyzed and evaluated, and finally summarized. This analysis is presented in a very easy way, describing the work of all these various authors that you have taken it from. So unlike the material in the original research article, this idea is not an original one. However, because it's an amalgamation of all these various studies, it can help to identify the gaps and give rise to new ideas in future studies. This manuscript does not contain the headings like that of the original research article. Since the researcher here is not performing any experiment or intervention, materials and methods is not the highlight here. In most of the review papers, it is not even present. The paper starts with the introduction, the body, and the conclusion. Methods, if it is present, basically includes how the literature was searched, what kind of a material was picked up, and if there was any statistical analysis, what was done. Then all this data that is collected will be evaluated so that the heading here is not going to be results, but the division will be based on what is presented. For example, if the review article is on how to protect the health personnel from COVID, the heading would be, because I'm a microbiologist, I would say it would be how to don a PPE, how to doff a PPE, what are the contents of the PPE, etc. Some of the very well-known studies are what is given, non-systematic analysis, systematic analysis, and meta-analysis. All these involve analyzing previous studies, so they can be included as types of review articles. But sometimes they're not included as review articles, but are independent of themselves. They are published as what their name states, a systematic analysis or a meta-analysis. And it can be introduced even in the journal's original article contents. That is, of course, the journal's preview. Since there is no experiment which is conducted in this kind of an article, who's the one who writes this article? These are the people who are proficient in the field of their study and have a vast experience. they would already have written so many original articles and have quite a few publications under their belt. So many times such people are invited by the editors themselves to write the review. People who read are also people who have an understanding and the knowledge of the subject. As a researcher, one would like to have a comprehensive knowledge of the topic instead of going through so many articles looking for it. For them also it's useful, especially if they are beginners in the field. The review article will give them an overall knowledge of the topic. While writing this kind of paper, one must remember that the audience who are going to read it are going to be a very wide audience. So it should be easy for them to read, an easy language with a few technical words. Since it's a comprehensive study, it is bound to be very long and lengthy. In a journal, the reviews normally are the ones that are the largest than any other manuscript, more number of pages. Again, as I said, the most important part in this review is the literature review. So the smallest review would be around 4,500 words, and some of the journals accept even 10,000 words or more as a review article. And as many literatures are collected, there should be around 75 to 100 references. This is an example of a review article. This article is actually 16 pages long, and I have just focused a couple of pages here. Since the topic is on emerging diseases, you can see that there is a very short introduction where the author is introducing why he is going to talk on the topic of emerging diseases. Then he starts with the past infection, and the article slowly brings about how the newer infections came about and how COVID came about, what was the signs and symptoms, mode of treatment, etc. None of this is what he or she has done, but it is what others have done. Whether it is noticing the signs and symptoms or treating the medication or observing the reaction and side effects, it is done by other people. This author has brought together all this material, and by just reading this one review article, we will know all the diseases along with COVID which had come over a period of time. This is just an example to show you how a review article is important to us. As I said, non-systematic review is one of the type of a review article. It just states what the others have stated. It does not use the writer's work like a systematic analysis or a meta-analysis, as I'm going to be talking, but it's just a compilation of various studies. Systematic analysis or systematic review is a critical review of literature. Although the material is taken from the literature only, there is a specific topic that is taken into consideration. And whatever in this literature comes into the purview of that topic, that is only included. All the others come under the exclusion criteria. So there is a specific inclusion and a specific exclusion criteria in this case. There's a specific objective also for this review, and it has to be clearly mentioned in the matter. Non-systematic review basically has a very broad subject and you are only compiling all the data that is there. But in a systematic review, there has to be a specific protocol and a research design. They also include, this one also includes many more articles than that of the literature review. So there should be no bias. At the end of this study, one should be able to see if the findings that you gather from this can be applied to the rest of the population also. So it should be very transparent and it should be easily replicable so that other researchers will also be able to do a similar work. This is an example of a systematic review. Here the authors have compared the symptoms of COVID in children and that of the adult. They have not done the examination on patients, but researched all the articles that had symptoms in the children and in the adults, and they have compared these two. So their inclusion was infection of COVID in adults and in children. Everything else, including the comorbidities of the adults, was excluded from the this particular systematic review. Another, I cannot actually talk about systematic review without mentioning the Cochrane collaboration. Cochrane, this is just a small information for you. It consists of a group of people who conduct systematic literature services, such as all in the healthcare system. These people are basically professionals in various fields of medicine. They can be researchers, doctors, patients, healthcare personnel, etc. The searches conducted by them meets a certain criteria and is compiled and assessed by using very stringent guidelines. One of the most important points to remember here is that there should not be any bias and all the information should be treated equally. These reviews are recognized as the highest standard in evidence-based healthcare. What you see in this slide are the general guidelines that they follow. Their results, when accepted by the publisher, are published in the Cochrane Library. Cochrane Library is the highest graded journal for systematic reviews in the world. Meta-analysis is another type of paper where the data is collected from the literature, so it can be included as a review. But there are some important, there is some amount of statistical analysis which is done in this case to arrive at the conclusion for a meta-analysis. The number of studies that are included in here can be as less as two or more. They evaluate the effectiveness and the strength of that topic by comparing or statistically analyzing the data which is predicted in the studies. Most of the time, these are randomized controlled trials which are analyzed. This includes its sample size, inclusion-exclusion criteria. Again, in this case, there cannot be any bias. Another very important, another very common type of a manuscript which is published in journals is the case study. This is also a scientific report like that of the original research article, but it is from a single patient. This could be an unusual disease. It could be a phenomenon that affects the patient which has not been heard of before. It can also be an unusual response to a particular treatment. It could be a different approach of giving the treatment to come to a better effect, which is basically known. Could be an emergence of an unknown disease. For example, before pandemic, when there were just a handful of cases of COVID in Wuhan, it started like a case study where the authors explained the extent of the disease in these few patients who died. But of course, now it's a different story. Everybody has very similar pneumonia and so many other things out of COVID. So usually a good case study marks a cornerstone in medicine. And to this, it is always referred to many times in future also. So this type of study has a detailed description of signs and symptoms, diagnosis, and treatment that is given, and also to the extent of follow-up that is done. It is usually something that the researcher wants everyone to know. So the case reports many a times helps us to get newer ideas also. Like the original research article, this is also written by the researcher or his team of researchers. But to know that this case is unique, the researcher must have an extensive practical knowledge. So basically, he will not be a person in his early career. But in case he is a novice, usually there will be somebody who will be a supervisor or a guide who will be guiding him, and he will be the expert in the field. So the case report has to have a significant contribution to the field of science in some kind of uniqueness. So the materials and methods are very important as they will describe the unique method that got a successful result or a different result which was otherwise not known. All these have to be described in detail. The discussion in this case is also of a very high value as it will tell the reader how this particular work differs from the rest of the work that is done till now. The whole case study is basically very short, only about 1,000 to 1,500 words with only 10 references. So when you're writing this particular case report, you have to realize that the language has to be very crisp and it has to be very short. This is an example of a case report. You can see that there is a very small, it is basically a very small paper. It's only 3 pages, and it's discussing only about a single case and a very few references. I think there are only 9 or 10 references in this case. So another type of manuscript is a short communication, which are small reports of an original research article. When there is a competition to get the data open fast, this is when it is used. The best example is this COVID situation. Everyone is studying it and everyone is working towards it. So to write a lengthy article, it will take a long time to gather so much of information. During this time, somebody else will publish whatever you have in mind. So under such circumstances, brief communication come in handy. They are published at the earliest by the publisher also. It focuses on a particular aspect that is expected to have a substantial effect to an existing knowledge. You can have many, you can have materials and methods and results in this case, but a short communication need not even have those headings. Typically, they have an abstract, they have an introduction to the topic, and they have the main body, which discusses whatever you want, and finally a conclusion. This is also based on the work that is done by the researcher. So the researcher is the one who writes this communication. Usually they are scientists who are in the middle of their research work and have not yet completed the total work. Again, people who are interested in the research, who are regularly reading the scientific journals and who want to keep up with the latest information, they are the readers for this particular article. Since it is a very short communication, maximum information has to be given in the least amount of words. So it should be technically savvy with less than 1,000 to 1,500 words, and you cannot have more than 10 references. This is an example. You can see that this particular short communication has all the regular headings that is there in even the original research article. Editorial is a person's opinion or a point of view of a particular person. It can be a short review or a critic of a previously written original article. More often, it is the theme of the journal, or it can be a description of an ongoing disease like COVID now. Again, let me take COVID as the example. Many journals who are publishing, who have a journal, an issue which is concentrating on COVID, will have an editorial on COVID also. It can be because all the articles are on COVID, or the editorial on COVID can also be because it is the hot topic nowadays. Usually, it is the privilege of the editor to write this editorial. Sometimes he can have an expert in the field. He can invite the person who has published a lot of papers to write an editorial. This is very much unlike all the other manuscripts I told till now. First of all, there is no abstract in an editorial. There is only a brief introduction, which is very general and aligns the reader to whatever is the matter that is coming up. Then there is a body which contains all the specific details, and then the conclusion. Again, since it is short, it is normally less than 1,000 words. Most of the time, it is the person's point of view, so there is no reference. But in case the author is citing somebody else, there can be references, but that should not be more than 5. This is an example of an editorial. You can see that this is on a topic which is very much prevalent nowadays, doctors and COVID. The author has collected information from newspapers and other articles, and she has given her own perspective. Letters to the editors are not written by the editor, but these are the letters which are written to him. The matter is normally critically evaluating a particular article, especially if there is a mistake by the author, or sometimes by the editor himself. It can be appreciating the article also, and can be adding more relevant points. This is basically the view of the author who is writing the letter. So it may be right, it may not be right. Whenever a person is writing the letter to the editor, relevant data which is supporting the claim must be present, especially if you are criticizing something. A letter can also be totally unrelated to the previous article. But if the author wants to express his own opinion, regarding any related health related issues, or if he wants to communicate an interesting case material, or even if he wants to write something about a prevalent situation like COVID now, letters will do the job. This is normally written when he is an expert in the field and who would know what is the difference between right and wrong. When writing a letter to the editor, especially if you're pointing out a mistake, it is extremely necessary to see that you are very courteous and never rude. One must remember that the person who has written the original article is an expert in the field. So you cannot at any point of time snub him. Whatever you have to say, be specific, never general. Also, when you are saying that there is a mistake, that means you know what is right. Present it. Always your claim must be supported with a proof. Plus, be brief. There's no need to go on and on. One automatically will understand what you're trying to say. So be short and brief. This is an example of a letter. The author here wanted to add more information on what is already written in the original article. So he starts with being very appreciative of the article, and the authors who are concerned with it. Then he adds his own points, which he thinks is right. So please go ahead, do some great research. There is no dearth of information, and all the journals are very happy to publish your hard work. Thank you.
Thank you for your kind and nice presentation. So now we started our question answer session. There is a number of questions we have, and on Facebook also we receive few questions on the mailer box as well in chat also. So ma'am, please go through the question. Dr. Kansal, you also please go through the question and provide the answer to the participants. Are you able to hear me?
Yes, we are able to hear you.
Yeah, so please provide the answer in the question answer segment below our bottom of our screen.
So Mr. Saeed Imam, he wants this presentation material.
So presentation material will be uploaded shortly on the website of ISRA. Please find there.
So should I type the answer or it is okay?
No, it is okay. You just answer the question live.
Okay. So who will be the principal author? The question from Janta Raut is, who will be the principal author among research scholar and his supervisor in a paper? So usually the research scholar is the principal author, and guides and co-guides or supervisor and co-supervisors are the second and third. Is it okay?
Yes, go ahead, sir. The next question, actually this is in the chat, so I will write here, that is how to select title for manuscript.
Yes.
Yeah.
So you will be answering it?
Sir, you can.
Okay. So the title is the gist of your article.
Okay.
So means it will depend on the research question also. So, it can depend on the results.
Okay. The next question is for Dr. Hema Bandhu.
Can I answer this? There is a question. Yes. Can a pilot study be published?
Yeah.
Yeah. The pilot study basically is an introductory study to a very large study that is about to come. So, basically, whatever are the materials and methods you are wanting to test in this pilot study. So you cannot actually, the pilot study is not authentic. You are only doing a trial and error. It's like a rehearsal before something. So pilot study is not generally published because there is a huge study which is coming and people would basically like to publish their original work than the small amount. The sample size is also very small in this case, which is not going to be authentic for a publication. So pilot studies are not normally published. But there are certain cases in certain journals wherein the pilot study itself is a complete study by its own, and every other thing that you are doing after this is based on the results of this pilot study. Some of the journals accept that. So that is the only way it can be published. It cannot be published otherwise. It should not be published otherwise.
Thank you, ma'am. So next question is, where to submit articles with you? So for that, I would like to answer. You can submit article through the www.innovpub.org. And there are a list of contributors who are academicians, practitioners, students from any discipline of their country, because they are, it publishes the number of specialty journals. So you can submit the article there, www.innovpub.org. Thank you. So next question is to Dr. Hema Bindu. And is created by Dr. Pusottam Giri. The question is, what can I do to increase the chance of having my paper accepted?
The paper, whatever is your work, let it be very crisp in your article. Every publication has a certain amount of words which are required. So see through it that your article is within that words. It should be crisp, it should be maximum informative. And once you read the article, we should be able to understand everything that you are trying to say with correct data and corroborative study which is supporting your data. So once you do that and it is crisp and the language is easy and understandable, I don't see any reason why it should not be accepted. Plus, of course, you have to check plagiarism. Plagiarism is not acceptable. You cannot, maybe in certain cases, there are sentences which you can't change. For example, if I say gram-negative bacteria, Staphylococcus aureus is a gram-positive bacteria, I can't really change this sentence and everybody would be using it. So things like that are unacceptable and they come in the acceptable range of plagiarism. So you should always see to it that your article is plagiarism-free. Once you do that, I don't see a reason why it cannot be accepted.
Wow, great. The next question is from Prashanta Mazumdar, and she is asking the same thing, that how to ignore plagiarism. Like example, if we have altered the sentence by using synonyms, it will help to avoid plagiarism. This is her question.
Can I answer that?
Yeah, please go ahead, ma'am.
If you alter the sentence, I'm sure just like the way you have this idea, many people would have the same idea. So preferably not. You have to write your own sentences. So your own sentences, the chances of being plagiarized is very, very little. But if you're going to take a sentence and you're going to, change the words and write it, ultimately somebody would have already done it, so it will still be plagiarized. As long as but in materials and methods and results, because that is your own study, there of course there is no plagiarism. Plagiarism basically will come in the introduction part and many a times in the discussion part, because the material you are referring to some other journal only. So there the chances are there to get plagiarized. So there you have to see that you try to maximize putting the same matter in your own words. Then the chances of plagiarism is less.
Okay, great. The next question is for Dr. Kansal. And the question asked by participant name is Najish Sahana. Can we publish individually without the help of principal as investigator?
No, it should not be done. That is unethical.
Okay. So Nazis, it is unethical, and so you can cross check this also. And the next question is, Dr. Mohammed Yasin asked that my PhD is on what is that?
Change of sex.
Yeah. Can the article is nightmare acceptable?
I suppose.
No, it means. But,
actually, this is not a subject-oriented question, so just avoid this. The next question is: there a standard for a number of pages of manuscript for the published?
Actually, every journal has their own standard. So you have to go to the journal site, look for the author's page, and see what is the instructions that they have given to the author. And yes, there is a standard. There is a certain number of pages. You cannot exceed a certain word limit. So you have to look into that. It is not standard for in general. It is between 3,000 and 4,000. So you have to go to the instructions for the authors and look in the journal that you are going to publish in, and you will find how many words to be added or how many pages to be done. They'll even give you what is the font size to use, what is the line spacing to use. All that also will be given. So it will be easier for you there.
This question is from Ethiopia, actually. Mulu Geta Chain was asking this question, the standard of number of pages of the manuscript to be published. So I would like to add one more point to Dr. Hima Bindu, that just go through the website of ipinnovative.com and go through the author guidelines. So you will find all the guidelines which we have to be followed for publishing an article. Thank you, Chain, for the nice asking this question. And the next question is, what is the guideline for manuscript and what is the limitation of words? Again, Esther, I would like to inform you that you, for the guidelines and this word limitation and this all things, you have to visit the websites for the author guidelines. These are the standard guidelines which is provided by the leading organization, international organization, COPE, NISO, and WAME, IJCME, so various leading organizations which are taking care of this guidelines will be adopted by Innovative also and all the leading publisher in the world. So go for the guidelines for websites of the publisher as well as organizations. So then one more question is from Kohima Agarwal to Dr. Hima Bindu. This is, what is the difference between pilot and pivotal study?
Your answer is there in the names itself. Pilot study is an initial study that you do before you do your major study. Most of it, it's done in randomized controlled trials, where you're going to test your methods to see if your other work will work or not. Pivotal means important. So the most important part of your whole research, that is your pivotal study. So that is in the middle, basically.
Pivotal also refers to the phase 3 trials. In the clinical trials, that is phase 3 trials for the approval of the drug.
Okay.
Allowed to be marketed by the FDA, the pivotal study is the phase 3 trial.
Okay, the next question is for Dr. Kansal and asked by Dr. Deepthi Arora. She's asking, is there any time limit to publish an original research article after completion of research?
It should be sent for publication as early as possible, because if you delay it, then it will be an old study. Somebody else may be doing the same.
Okay.
I don't know.
Okay. You have to cross-check. Dr. Hima Bindu, would you like to answer this question?
basically you have started doing your research because that was the in thing at that time. So the better thing would be to immediately try and publish your research. But if your research is in such a way that, you know, it's an evergreen topic, then yes, you can publish it after a while. But once it's too long, then your whatever is your material becomes redundant. So preferably not too long. There should be an age limit, and almost about 1 year later, it's fine. But after that, there is no point in publishing because somebody else would have already done that.
The next question is for you, Dr. Hemabindu. He is asked, because Raisal asked that case studies are not published in high impact factor journals. Is it true, madam?
No, not at all. It is not true. They are published. Almost every journal has a review article. It has the original research articles, which are quite a few. The maximum are the original research article. But there will be a case study also. So it is not true. It is very much published by even high impacted journals.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Dr. Kansal. Thank you for your help for answering the questions of participants and Dr. Hemabindu also. Actually, there is a huge number of questions people are asking here. So can you write on the email ID editor.iesrf@gmail.com, we would answer maximum question which we can on the email also. So lots of people are asking also for the feedback link. So when this program is completed, the evaluation link is automatically appear on the on your PC. So you can fill it out and submit it and download your e-certificate from our website www.iesrf.org. You can find the e-certificate download option is there. So now we can move towards the end of the session and on thanks votes. So I would like to thanks all the participants from different countries. People are joining us. The number of countries like from Ethiopia, Philippines, Manila, and Sri Lanka, Pakistan, New York, and from London also someone joined. And thanks for joining us and this informative session, and thanks Dr. Kansal for your presence and share your knowledge on the very important topic. Thanks Dr. Hemabindu for your presence and share your knowledge about the nice topic, the types of manuscript. It is very important topic for all the researchers. So thank you all. And after this completion of this webinar, you will find a evaluation link. Please give your feedback to us. Thank you. Have a great evening. Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone, who joined.
I would like to share one more information. If someone from someone of your colleague or anyone else want to see this webinar video from on Facebook or on YouTube, then please subscribe the channel on YouTube from AIPinnovativepublication.com. We will share the link with the Zoom links also. Thank you for joining. Goodbye to all of you.
Thank you.
Thank you.